Whatever we have covered till now, we started the compiler construction. We are now in the middle of the string. We have finished top-down parsing, but lot of things for top-down parsing is not covered. I'll cover it, like how to error handling the top-down parsing. But before that, I always stress upon you, please remember this grammar. This is very, very important grammar. This is called the expression grammar. What is the earlier expression grammar? Before that, the expression grammar was like this. E2 E plus E, and E2 E E, I, and E2 E star. You can take it as a, say, 4.0. So what is the problem with this grammar? This problem of this grammar is you cannot take multiplication before star. So in anywhere they will be equivalent. So plus will be calculated earlier, or might be 50-50 chance where they start. So we have to modify this grammar to make the star to be more earlier than plus. We introduce the term t, and then t is equal to t star f. It should not be f, it should be e. Excuse me, sorry, this e, p, yeah. So t star e and e, and so here we see that the first and emphasis on bracket, that is also here, but to differentiate between plus and star, so we have introduced one more terminal t. Now we also know for top-down parsing, this form we have to get rid of, because there is a left recursion. E is here, T is here. It is not good for, it is unambiguous grammar, but this is ambiguous grammar, because you don't know at what time plus will be there, what time star is there. So this grammar is ambiguous. This grammar is ambiguous, because you can have two different plus t's. Sometimes plus will be calculated first and second time. Then this grammar is unambiguous. Unambiguous. What the change I have done? We have done it here. Here we have put a t. So, and t will be calculated first by this. But this grammar is not fit for LL1, because t comes here. That is the reason we have a grammar last time we incorporated e dash and t dash. So instead of 6 rules, we have had another 2 more rules, e dash and t dash. And then we can see that is good enough for top-down LL1 parsing predictive. But this grammar is good for our bottom-up parsing, because you know the bottom-up parsing is more general. It doesn't require, if it's a left recursion, doesn't matter. Only the grammar has to be unambiguous. If it is a, in the contrary, you can see if it has a recursive on the right-hand side, that is also doesn't matter. So bottom-up parsing is more stronger, it can take more type of grammar, bottom-up parsing. Now, what is a bottom-up parsing philosophy? So we take a sample string here. It's a sample string here, opening bracket, id plus id. This is the terminal. Remember, these are all terminals. Opening versus terminals. So opening bracket close and dollar is end of marker. This is a bottom-up parsing program, and there is always a different table than whatever we have done. But here you see it is simple. So if you have a grammar like this, so if you have a grammar, your input is like this. Yeah. If your input is like this, see, first I have told you in top-down parsing, your stack should contain S. But bottom-up parsing, triple reverse. Stack should be empty. So first step one, or this is the input, is the step zero. The step one, you put the left marker into this, into the stack. Not S, stack. And then you try to match this opening bracket to any other rules. You find it, the rule is there, but you cannot replace this with this because you need the whole this thing to put into T or the top of the stack. So what is the weight? That is the shift. This has becoming called a shift. Now input pointer become from here to it goes to shift. This is called shift reduced grammar also. This shift. Then I put the value ID, dropped it here. So this is the stack condition earlier. Now this is the stack condition. I put the ID here. Then I try to find the rule. You can find that this rule matches P into the IT, rule number 6. So by rule number 6, you can reduce this ID to T by rule 6. By rule 6, you reduce ID, you take out pop ID, pop, and push T, but your input is there. Input is still there. Input is your left bracket is gone off. Okay, fine. So that way we will proceed. We come to the screen and we'll show it to the rest of the screen because I could draw, but this is the picture. Let's come to the screen. Thank you. So this is where we are in our, this is the original grammar, and here is the part stick is only dollar, that is the end of stack marker, but here it is shown nothing, but it is the dollar is there, the end of stack marker. Remaining input, whatever I have shown in the board, full input, and it can go only left to right. Parser action is shift. So shift means it put the opening brace to the stack. Okay. Then again shift. Next is a shift. Then again ID comes here. This ID in remaining input it is not there. Then you reduce this ID by TID. This rule. You remember this rule? Pop right hand side of the production of the stack. This production and push left hand side, no change in input. Input should be there. So if what you have done, we pop ID by this rule, put T. So look, its stack is look like this. And whatever you have done, your input is look like this. Plus ID dollar reduced by E by T. That is the rule number. That is E. Then again, first T, then we again replace T to E. Okay, but your input is same. First you go for ID to T, then so this rule T to E. So here we come, then but input is still there. Again shift. What is shift? You push plus to the input stack. So whenever I make a shift, so plus is dropped to the stack, at the top of the stack is E plus. Now again shift. Then again ID comes to here. The E plus ID, the top of the stack is ID, and your input string is only a closing bracket and dollar. Now you reduce T to ID by this rule. Again I applying this rule. Now your E plus T comes here. Now there are two rules. Say here you have E plus T. So you can make this rule. But here you see that we have a reduced T. There's a two option. We can make a ignore. There's a two option, E to T or E to E plus T. So we ignore this option. This is a critical point. How to, you have now two option and you have to ignore this and you have to go for this. If you say by any trick I ignore this, but this is these things make it bottom up parser is more, you have to have a bigger parsing table with go to action. Then we can see that the parsing table, that parser, that your stack should contain the is another stack variable. We'll come to that. May not be today, but I want to impress upon you, there are right now two options. Whenever that stack is E plus T, we can make it E
plus t, we can make it e, or we can make a we can take this e plus e. So both options, but we ignore this option. Then we got e plus t reduced to e, and then we again shift, then it is come this, then it is similar this rule. Then you put t, you put t here dollar, then you put e here by this rule, by t to e is this rule, and then e to s is so bottom up parsing. At the end, your start variable will be there. Remember, in top down parsing, you put start variable at the beginning, and then you, but remember, never any time the input string fully goes into the stack. In both the cases, stack is only used for manipulation. So, but the what is the difference between bottom up parsing and top down parsing? One is, initially stack should be empty in the bottom up parsing, but whenever you are reducing, shift and reduce, sometimes you have a conflict. That is, which rule to, that's called the reduce conflict. Whenever you want to reduce, you can have more than one rules, which rule to follow up. So reduce conflict, and sometimes you have shift reduce conflicts. There are some chance to reduce it, or there is, you can shift it. That's shift reduce conflicts. So if, how we can avoid this conflict and make a always deterministic, no chance taken parsing, that will cover it by a more different types of technique. Along with the parsing stack, we can include a condition of the stack which represent the what is beneath in the stack is called stack in stack conditional behavior. Within this, we can manipulate, we can conflict this, and for reducing the conflict, this kind of conflict, we have a huge parsing table there. It can handle this kind of conflict. So these are tables, the most biggest table is LR1, and then the LLR1 is a kindly smaller table, then SLR, much smaller table. So SLR1, we remember LR0 will never use, because in our examples also LL0, only 0 look ahead will not see anything. Okay, so this is, any question till now, anyone? No top down parser or bottom up parser cannot handle ambiguity. So before choosing a grammar, we have to divide up all ambiguity, ambiguous grammar. And you also know that ambiguous, unambiguous grammar can be available only deterministic context-free grammar. But all deterministic context-free grammar is not unambiguous. So we have to select your grammar, and so that no ambiguity should be there. So for your programming language. Okay. And then the parsing. These programs are available. So this is one of your tasks will be there in the second assignment. That you have to use the third party tool like Yak, like Bison, like Lex. These are the tools, how to handle these tools. You give the rules and it will generate the parser. So this grammar in typical programming languages may consist of thousands of rules. So it is impossible, because here we have 7 and 8 rules. We can make a table which is visible. But if a standard programming language may be thousands of rules for integer, floating point number, string, and all the rules are there. These rules, it is to be the parsing table generation. Though LL1 parsing table is the easiest one, but we'll see it. We have already faced the difficulty that reduce conflict. We have two rules. Which one to reduce? If we go for wrong rule, then we cannot parse. So then we have to take any other rule. So then it is a chance factor is coming. It is not deterministic. So we have to avoid that. We can avoid that by putting into a stack what is the stack variable, what is within the stack, how is the condition is there. We can environment variable. So we push two variables right now. One is there from input string and also stack variable. Within two conditions, we can check the which go-to action will be there, because now the parsing table consists of a go-to action table. We've seen, but anyway, this is same. Top-down, see, another thing I must tell you, that other than top-down parsing and bottom-up parsing, there is another parsing, that is general parsing technique. That is, the compiler is CYK algorithm, but it takes O n cube. So we are not discussing there. You might ask that parsing can only be done top-down or bottom-up. No, there is another technique that is more exhaustive technique, CYK algorithm, famous CYK algorithm, but it takes O n cube. But in our modern programming languages, our processor is so fast, we have so much memory. So I never told you that in our programming languages, 100% rules are context-free grammar, or it should obey the bottom-up parsing technique. No, there for absolutely powerful programming, and because you know the programming becoming, you have to make less and less, so you don't have to be machine friendly like your C language. So in our Python, Java, we have to be particularly Python, we have to be programmer friendly. So for programmer friendly, you cannot have both. Programmer friendly and machine friendly, you cannot have both. So programmer friendly, you can use some more higher grammar, like context sensitive grammar, which is unambiguous definitely. Therefore, there you need the parsing, maybe NP complete, or you reduce to much better, or in some case ON cube. So we may, in that particular rules, we can use CYK algorithm, which upper limit is ON cube, sometimes ON square or ON to the power 2.5. So there is two techniques we are highlighting in all textbooks, but if you follow the AO after in chapter 4, it is written specially that there is another technique called general parsing techniques. CYK algorithm is the example of it, and you know the context-free grammar, the upper limit of parsing is ON cube, but programming language ON cube is absolutely no. We have to go for ON. We have already proven the top-down parser, deterministic top-down parser, sometimes called recursive descent. You see the different names in different books, but always remember the names. One is the brute force technique, that any parsing can be done by brute force techniques, by top down, but it takes inordinate time, it takes inordinate space. So we go for recursive descent. Recursive descent, whenever we disallow the rules for all left recursion removed, and any variable goes to epsilon, then fast and follow is shy, and all, any variable go to light sensor, any expressions, we see the first of all are shy. So if we follow, then it will be definitely a top-down parsing, and it will not give a problem. So then we will make a parsing table that we have already completed, and there is no problem, absolutely good. But only problem is top-down parsing it. Your grammar looks like little bit of what I can say, it is difficult for programmers. But we can see the expression grammar today without this modification T dash and E dash, we can handle it to the bottom up parsing. So bottom up parsing is more general. You don't need to remove the left recursion. So bottom up parsing is the best example. The toughest is LL1 today. What we have covered, only shift reduce bottom up parsing technique, but you can refine it better and better, so that there will be no confusion. This is only shift reduce, but all bottom up parsing is basically shift reduce. Why I am talking shift reduce? You put a from input string into the put it into the bottom to the stack, and try to match a rule. Okay, that is it. Then the top down parser starts with the root of the, that I have already number of times I have told here, nothing much. Simple expression grammar. This is all terminals. So a third bracket in any book, if you found this, a third bracket is always a terminal. These are the terminal. Okay, let's see. Left recursion, I have told that top down parser cannot handle left recursion in grammar. Like there is A always, and it should not appear here. And this is a direct left recursion, and sometimes I have given an example, indirect left recursion cannot be handled also. Like here we have A go to B alpha and B goes to A bar beta. So that is indirect. Both has to be removed for the top down parsing. To remove, you can transform the grammar. Yes, you have transformed the grammar. This is called left factoring. It is sometimes called the left factoring. Yes. So this is obvious in any books. Free of epsilon pronunciation, it generally is associated with some things. Yeah? This example is not so. Let's see how much. It's always, this is very important. I've told you many number of times how much look ahead is needed. Whether you go for zero look ahead, one look ahead, two look ahead. We'll see it with zero look ahead, you cannot do anything much. Say LL0 is very small setup grammar, even LR0 is bigger than LL0, but it is not useful. But if you look ahead only one, then it is immensely powerful. And if you enhance another two, then it will be more powerful. But you can ask why you are not using LL2 or LR2. Will not, because you see here the LL1 parsing table is okay. If I go for LL2 parsing table, that will be huge. And also same for LR1. LR1 table definitely much huge than this, maybe 100 times more than this, or at least 10 times. And if you go for 2, it will be 10,000 entries for a few rules. So it is not acceptable, because you know this parsing table has to be in the memory, and it will take memory, it will make the parsing slower. So generally all modern languages are only one look ahead is enough. And here the famous parsing algorithm, anyone can take a presentation on this, is a good algorithm. You have to know anyway, Kocki-Younger-Kesami algorithm. This is it. It uses early the both two actors. It is general purpose compiler. This is general purpose parsing. It takes around n to the power 2.5 or 3. You can see it. It is a very general purpose. It is probably out of the syllabus. Okay. So LL1 is a left to right scan, left port derivation, one token look ahead. LR1 left to right, one token. So one is enough. So where do I start? One is enough. But LR1. It takes all grammars, okay, LR1 and LL1 subset, proper subset of LR1. So for most of the programming languages, 99 of the programming languages will have the LR1. Predictive parsing we have covered. This is, you already know that any, it should be shy, faster alpha and faster beta, anything good. So left factoring I have told, this is how to avoid the left recursion. You can go for left factoring. What is left factoring? If A is there like this, alpha is common. So with this changing of the rules, you can remove the left factoring. It is called left factoring. You remove left recursion. Left recursion. The A dash is a phrase value. I think all are things covered. Let's see example. Anything new I will tell you. Recursive descent. This is, I have covered this algorithm. Building the tree line. Yeah, this is basically all parsing. Sometimes you see scanner, some people say lexer, it will tokens, and there is always an error to be handled. And another thing is not shown here, that is a symbol table. Symbol table is being filled up during scanning, and whenever it is parsing, there is also data comes to the symbol table. That I have told you again and again. This is a parsing table. The parsing tables are generally done by another computer program like Yak. These parsing tables are different for top-down parsing and for bottom-up parsing. This is the table-driven. All are generally table-driven parser. Okay. First of all are table-driven, but programming is different. And there is a stack. This stack. So you see the how to use the stack. You in your function, you know how to use the stack. You put, whenever you call function recursive, you know, once again and again, you put the all the variables into the stack. That is one use of stack. then in your whenever in a graph you are a bottom up, you are going to the depth first search, you put all the child nodes into the stack and you go to the top and go to the again stacks. As a depth first search, you need a stack. Now you see the use of stack here. Top down parsing, you are using stack. In also bottom up parsing, you are using stack. So stack is very essential tool for computer science. So it has many use. Yeah, the table driven parser. This is, I have told you, parser generator. That is your assignment in the. You have to use at least one parser generator, and that available. That is tool is available. That you have to show that you select a rule and use the parser generator and also Lexer. This how to make this. So this is the second assignment. Elimination of left of recursion. This I have taken from Aho's book. The better copy is available in the my next slide. See here we input the power. We incorporate the value a dash. Earlier rule is a to a alpha. We put it a to beta a dash. A dash goes to this is a new variable and we by left factoring you remove left recursion. But remember, this variable can go to epsilon. So for top-down parsing, we have to check that first of these and follow of this should be shy. Yeah, that too I have already covered. This is your original expression grammar. It comes in Aho's book. Very, very important. And this is also unambiguous grammar. And that is fit case for bottom-up parsing, but not for top-down parsing. For obvious reasons, E is here, E is here, T is here, T is here. So this is not good for bottom up, top down parsing, but this is good for bottom up parsing. For top down, you have to remove the left recursion. So left recursion, after removing this rule, we add two extra things, e dash and t dash. You get this general how to remove left recursion, Aho's book. This is called left factoring. The how you remove the left recursion, the procedure is called left factoring. Let's see. The first calculation, you all know how to calculate first. It is first means if you say capital X goes to capital Y capital Z like this, if you the first of X will be first of capital Y. If capital Y any Y variable goes to epsilon, then you catch the next to Z capital Z. So like this, whenever you calculate it first, but if it reaches dollar, you don't include dollar into the first. Whenever you calculate first. You should take the if it is a first of a terminal is always a terminal. First of a variable is the variables has many rules. If any rule it starts with another variable that goes to epsilon and that next variable is y, so you have to take first of y. If y derives to some z, then y to epsilon is a there, then you have to go first of j. So that way, if any go anywhere goes to epsilon, you would take the next first, and epsilon should be there. But in follow calculation little bit tougher. You have to first calculation first, and then follow. You first take the start symbol S, and there will be always a dollar. And if S comes between in the right hand side anywhere, then you have to take first of this. So this is I have already explained, and follow it is there.